Hello. That's a lot of audience. My name is Ahmed. I won't even try to pronounce my last name for you. You can try and read it. Can put together a challenge for that. So thank you for coming to listen to my rant on incident management. A little bit about me. I came to New Zealand straight from Egypt 2 years, 10 months, and 9 days ago. I just came after working in the Middle East in different countries. I worked with QCert, Qatar's National CERT, which was built in partnership with Carnegie Mellon University CERT. And I'd just like to share some of the experiences that I've had in incident management and some of the scars that happened to me or I've seen happen to others, so that hopefully they won't happen to you. A lot of people tend to think of incident management as, well, it's a process, it just needs to be there for compliance purposes. Well, it doesn't help. It doesn't really reduce impact. I hope by the end of this talk, I can convince you otherwise. Which of these sound familiar to you? Have you heard it in a place you've worked for before, your current place? Show hands if you have ever come across any of these. Wow, a lot of hands, good. So things like, yeah, well, we don't have anything important. Why do you exist as an organization if you don't have anything important then? It will never happen to us. Well, think again. It has never happened before, or we will engage a third party when it happens, so we don't need to worry about it. Or it's our service provider's problem. It's not our problem. Somebody else will sort it. And of course, the most recent, it's in the cloud. Why should we care? It's in the cloud. It's just our information. Okay, so especially if you think you don't have anything valuable for someone to steal from you or to compromise, do you know who's that guy? Anybody? Well, his name is Willie Sutton. The guy is obviously on the FBI page, famous cases, and they call him an illegal withdrawal specialist, a thief, in other words. Well, but he was a very elegant thief and a gentleman, but he was a very good con artist. What's really special and makes this guy famous and on the FBI most famous cases is this sentence. When asked why he robbed banks, Sutton simply replied, "Because that's where the money is." Why would anybody be interested in you? Because you have some value to offer. What's the value of a piece of paper that says, well, $100? It has some value because you can exchange it for some real value. The same thing you have in your organization. You have something that someone out there wants and can exchange it for some real value. Whether that's directly exchangeable to a real value, or they will use you as a staging point to attack somebody else, so that is providing them a value. If you want to build a server to attack someone, you pay money to build the server. If you can own the infrastructure of someone and use it to attack some other person, well, that's worth money. If you can use the identities of people in your organization to attack your customers, that's value. So you have something to offer. Well, I've also came across a number of other lame excuses about why we shouldn't have incident management. Why it doesn't matter? Well, with all due respect to the pen testers in the room, and pen testing is quite important, and you need to have it, but that's what pen testing tells you. You're either terrible, or we couldn't figure out, nothing really we could discover at the moment. But again, yeah, we've heard the people saying, well, we're running Mac, we're running Linux, it's secure. I've even come across one really interesting excuse, and it was coming from a bank, but thankfully this bank is not in New Zealand, it's somewhere in the Middle East, where they said that. Okay. I don't see how it's that relevant, but somehow someone out there says, and well, he was actually a board member, and he told me, well, we've invested a lot of money on those firewalls. Why would we need incident management? Yeah, I don't think so either. You don't really need incident management. You need a change in management. So in real life, you trust those guys. You know you can pick up the phone, dial 111, and somebody out there will respond. And you don't expect those people, let's say the fire service, to arrive at the scene where there is a fire, and the guys start taking off their helmets, scratching their head and thinking, oh well, how can we put that off? How can we find out if it's caused by chemical substance, electricity? How can we find out if the building was evacuated or not? You don't expect them that. You expect them to come prepared, knowing what they need to do. And we're so dependent on them. Well, your organization is also so dependent on a number of systems and services. Why do you expect otherwise? Why would you, as an organization, accept to live without similar emergency response teams? I just hope that your organization's plan for responding to incidents is not that. Well, that's basically what I find in a lot of organizations. Well, some though do tend to swipe it under the carpet and don't even scream for help. The thing is, do you have really someone to contact when, not if, something bad happens? Well, what if you don't realize that something bad happens, but I, as an external party, find out that there is your site is serving malware? Documents, classified documents that belong to your organization, published somewhere. How can I even report that to the organization? Do you expect me to get into that web page, call whatever in the contact page there, whatever number, and tell them, hey, I've just found out some of your documents published on the internet, and I want to talk to someone from security. Do you expect that? Maybe. Would the person who would pick up the phone know who's the right person in your organization to direct this to? Do they even know that person who will pick up the phone and answer me? Do they even know what to ask me about other than, well, what's your name? How can we call you back? So hopefully you get somebody who can respond immediately and hopefully fix it, not really damage it. Distinguish between what is a rapid response and a careful response. So you might want not to destroy the evidence if you hope to legally pursue your rights. And that doesn't just happen because, well, I don't have anyone, and I'll call a third party, or it will never happen to us. And of course, if you consider some requirements like the GDPR requirements, which are coming in action if you're doing something in Europe, then you get fined 4% of your total global organization revenue if you fail to report on incidents affecting the data protection of your European clients. I imagine that's a lot of money. But it's not only about the people that you can call and contact. A lot of organizations that I've seen have incident management capabilities and have the teams who are prepared and know what to do. But the organization itself thinks of, well, it's just a technical problem. What is incident management? Some people will go through the servers and logs, and those technical IT people will just, do it, whatever that is. You need the organization to realize that incident management is actually part of operational risk management. We don't do it because, well, we like it. It's attractive. It's challenging to hunt down attackers. We just don't do it because we like it. It's an operational risk management activity. So it needs to address operational risk. And it actually reduces the impact. At Zenik, we do a lot of risk assessments, and in a lot of cases, the arguments during the risk assessment workshop, when you put incident management as a control out there, is, well, what could it do to me? The incident already happened. My data is out there. It's useless. I don't think so. It makes a lot of difference if you know what to do about it. Let's get some terminology out of the way. I've been talking about incident management. We hear incident response. We hear incident handling. So simply identifying plus responding, that is handling. Add to handling, improving and preparing, that is management. So it is just that simple. You can say, well, we call it incident response teams. We call the position an incident handler position. The whole process is an incident management process because it involves measuring and improving and preparing as well. But the issue is, one of the issues that I've found throughout my career is that people represent incident management process, and that is the way you will find it when you Google it, when you go to any course that talks about incident management. It is represented as such, a linear process, starting by preparing, detecting, triaging, analyzing, containing, recovering, and post-mortem review, then start it all over again. I am guilty of representing the incident management process that way myself. On a Zenik blog, I have a series on incident management that I hope to complete at some point of time. It's called Rapid Reaction. It's about building incident management capabilities for organizations. And I have represented the incident management process in some linear form. Unfortunately, it is not that linear. It also involves, well, while you're doing triage, you get back, you still continue detecting and reporting, and while you're doing analysis, you find correlated incidents, so you come back to triage. Some new incidents come up, and, well, they take precedence on the current incidents that you're handling. While you're containing, it doesn't work, so you go into analysis. So it's not that linear. I even wish it was that simple. You also jump from analysis and you continue detecting and reporting as you're analyzing, and as you are in the recovery, you still do some analysis and so on. And it's not even that simple. So you get the gist of it, right? So So it's not as linear as it is represented. I've seen some textbooks represented over a timeline where you start by the detecting and reporting and it moves over time, and then later on in the stage you start by triage and then it moves over time. I think we're kind of lacking a better representation of the incident management process, and that's why a lot of people think an incident management process don't really work. And I don't have the answer for that, I just don't know. So it is a problem. If someone has an answer, please come and see me after the presentation. I'd love to hear from you. Okay, so it is not a straightforward process, but it works as a process. But I don't have an incident management capability in my organization. Where do I start? It's so complicated, I know nothing about it. It's not really that complicated. It is simple three steps, but they are quite important to follow them in that order. So you start by defining incidents. A lot of organizations that I work with mix between security incidents and ITIL incidents, service delivery incidents. So for ITIL, an incident is an unplanned interruption of an IT service or a reduction in the quality of an IT service. Is that an information security incident? That just touches on the availability aspect. Confidentiality, integrity, maybe privacy if you handle it with the same incident response procedure. Doesn't count as part of that. Security incidents, you need to define them for your own organization's benefit. It differs from an organization to the other, and you need to communicate that definition really well across the organization. So, who thinks scanning and probing is a security incident? Anybody? Okay. Actually, it depends. So, I bet if you have services published on the internet, well, scanning and probing is part of the ongoing activity. If the scanning and probing is coming from your internal network, that's completely different. If you're a university and scanning and probing is coming from your internal network, would you even consider that an incident? Well, that's what students do. They poke around. That's going to be business as usual for a university as well. How about defense? Anything that gets scanning or probing might be considered an incident. So you need to consider what your organization does, identify what meets the threshold of being an incident, and work from there. If you don't know this yourself as an incident management team, and if your organization doesn't know this, then this is the beginning of the problem. Then you need to plan for it. Planning actually works. So a lot of organizations, when you start helping them in handling incidents, and well, you start asking, well, what do you log? And they say, well, the default. What is the default? We don't know, whatever comes out of the box when you set up Windows, Linux, whatever. And okay, where do you log those? On the box? Have you considered the box being compromised? No. Okay, where is your network diagram? How are those things hooked together? Well, we know how they are. There's this piece of paper that's been hanging around in the wall catching dust for the past 3 years without being updated whatsoever. And they say, well, it's some variation of that. And when you get to look at it, it's not even close. So planning actually works. You need to plan and prepare. You don't want to think about those things as you're handling an incident. There is a lot more into planning. Then you just detect and respond and continue improving your plans as a result. So let me just walk you now through few of the topics that I've personally got stuck in or seen people get stuck in. It's an InfoSec technical problem. None of our business as an organization. We really don't care. Some of the technical guys will fix it. Do you hear that? Do you come across that? See a lot of nodding. There's no incident definition or it's not communicated. Well, we've talked to that already. It's dependent on reporting only. So, well, when someone reports an incident, we'll work something out. Or we're prepared only if someone reports an incident. Well, I think you need to live on the premise that you're actually infiltrated until you can prove through log reviews otherwise. And there are things as well that you can't just figure out through log reviews, and that's why incident management is not just a technical problem. So some of you might be aware that the US found out that their power companies were infiltrated by, well, what they say is police, Chinese intelligence. And well, that was the reason for them bringing up NERC as a standard for their control systems and power industry. They found out that in a lot of tenders where they bid in South America for power plant designs and control system designs of power plants, the Chinese were able to beat them every time using a really close design to what they have proposed, and they beat them like by 5 to 10% less in price. That's a business thing. That is not something that you will find out from the logs, right? So the business could tell that this has been consistently happening, and accordingly they started looking into the logs on that premise, and they found out that they were infiltrated, and that was the case. So it is not a technical problem. You can't just find it when somebody reports it. You need the business to work alongside with the technical people to be able to find it. Well, next one is interesting. No incident will look like that. You won't find an axe in the middle of the system. You won't find red flags and shining lights and, well, blowing balloons, as we've seen yesterday. Sorry, you won't get that type of alert. Actually, the red alerts might be precursors to incidents. If attackers take it low and slow, which they normally do, they are patient, as we have heard from multiple presenters before, then even those red alerts would be an indication to nothing for you if you're reviewing the logs. What you need to look at in the logs is those green ticked logs that says, well, access granted, connection established. You know what? That access granted was granted to somebody who shouldn't have accessed that information. That connection established was actually a connection that contained your corporate information being exfiltrated to some server somewhere in the world. So that's what you need to look into, the successful stuff rather than, well, the red flags. And of course, logging systems are guilty for marking things with a big X or a big red. When a control actually works, when your firewall blocks a connection it is supposed to block, right? That's when, well, they show you the big X in red. No triage. A lot of organizations just get into incident management directly by jumping into analysis. They think, well, triage, well, we have one incident in hand. What would triage do? It's not really that important. Well, in triage, you make sure, well, of course, you prioritize incidents if you have multiple. But what would, in the medical world, because we borrowed triage from the medical world, what would they do in the medical world during triage other than, well, prioritizing somebody with a heart attack over someone with a bleeding finger? What would a nurse do in triage? Gather information, right? They start collecting information about you, about what happened, about how it happened, what you are allergic against, what you are sure about, what you're not sure about, so that they can proceed based on that information. Knowing that information, they don't need to proceed and work to fix you in some direction that doesn't work at the end because they didn't stop. Pause for a moment to collect that valuable information about you, about the incident, about how it happened, about where it actually hurts. Is that the extent of it? Do you have an internal bleeding? They need to find that out. All those questions, it's part of triage. They try to find that out. Well, in incident management, I rarely find, especially technical people, posing for a moment to collect information. In triage, you need to look at, well, what do we know? What we don't know? What we think we know? Because there are things, well, you put as what we know, but it's actually not that you know. It is things that you think you know. So you need to gather all that information beforehand. It helps a lot. I've been recently party in tabletop incident response tabletop exercise that for once I didn't run myself. I was supporting one of our clients for which we developed an incident management process for. And immediately the techies in the room jumped into the analysis of the presented incident and start, well, saying, well, we'll turn that off, we'll look at that log, we'll find out, we'll block those connections, we'll and so on. Well, after pausing for a moment and looking at the information we could collect from the people presenting the incident, that thing only got us through a tabletop exercise that is scheduled for 3 hours, and in average, most of the people that go through that don't solve it even in 3 hours. We got through it in 35 minutes, just by pausing for a few minutes, collecting the information. It took us through the right path immediately. Well, people a lot of times get stuck in analysis. They just don't move. That linear process, they just get into analysis and keep analyzing until the incident management process is not useful anymore. Again, sorry to the techies, but you guys get hooked up. It's a challenge, I understand. It's lovely, I'd love to do it. I'd be intrigued to do that myself. But this is operational risk management. And in risk management, time is important. So if you continue doing analysis forever, you won't move forward. And you need to move forward. You can always come back to analysis when, if needed, but don't get stuck there. Some people just jump steps. Well, let's jump to containment or eradication or recovery. Well, we've got a ransomware, that's fine. We have our backups, we'll just reimage the computer, restore the backup, we're good. Well, you forgot to look at how that ransomware got in the first place. And the next thing you know is that computers will start popping up with the same ransom note over time. You just jumped into recovery. Some people skip some of those steps. I don't know how they restore the services, but they skip some of those steps. Well, a big problem as well that I've come across is blameful postmortems, or useless postmortems, or no postmortems whatsoever. And again, I'm not saying do a review or a postmortem on every single malware infection that you get, or an identity compromise in a 6,000 employees organization. Not necessarily. At least do it every, well, period of time, 3 months, 6 months, whatever. Threshold, well, every 4 lost devices will look at it, will sit and look at the pattern, where they were lost, what time, how were they lost. So you need to do that every now and then, every threshold. Of course, it needs to be blameless. So pointing fingers at each other wouldn't help at all. People will simply stop reporting incidents, stop acting on incidents as well. And the best one I love, communication failure. If you have worked for Equifax or still work for Equifax, I'm feeling really sorry for you, but Equifax has done every single mistake you can do in communicating about an incident. Every single one of them. Well, this is, for example, one. So if you log from the mobile and check if your information was compromised versus if you log from your laptop, you will get different responses. Well, one will tell you, you may have been compromised, and the other will tell you, you're fine, everything is fine. What's really interesting is, well, just people in these positions, because they are not prepared, they don't think somebody will look deeper and find out shit. Sorry, people can enter any sort of rubbish in the fields for the check, and you will get the same message. You don't have to enter your last name or the last 4 digits of your social security number to get a reply. Just enter anything in those 2 fields and submit, and you will get the exact same reply. So, well, people are not prepared. What was the mobile site where you can, what was the site where you can check whether your records were compromised or not? Anybody knows? No? Equifaxsecurity2017.com. Well, what's that? So even that site was marked as spam by Google for a while. So that's what you get if you're not prepared. That's what you get if you fail to communicate. What about, well, while we're relaxed, not really handling any incidents, nothing, nobody's putting pressure on us, sitting, investing few hours to create a template for internal and external communication in case of incidents. Well, how long would that take? 4 hours from, well, one technical, one management, and a PR person. Create a template and then customize it later on. It's not that difficult, but it will save you a lot of time, and it will save you faces, most importantly. When you do that, before you're actually into an incident. You need just to customize it when you are into an incident. You'll know what you need to do. Again, think about GDPR, if it applies to your organization, if you're doing any services in Europe. Think about that. How will you notify authorities if there is a breach? 4% of your global organization revenue is at risk of a fine. Well, how much are you willing to invest for that? So, in short, this is basically what I wanted to pass across. Incident management is just an essential operational risk management activity that works for all organizations. As long as you have something to offer, as long as your organization exists, there is some value out there, you need incident management as part of your operational risk management. You do it for the business, not because it's fun and challenging. Well, personally, you might do it because it's fun and challenging, but the business is investing in it because it's operational risk management. It's not just technical, and it's not either linear. So just consider that. The business needs to buy in. In reality, if you have a process, it doesn't slow you down. It actually works. You might think at the beginning that, well, a process, why would we need that? It would just slow us down. Process doesn't always mean that you have to get a piece of paper and fill it, or a form or something and fill it. It just ensures that you can repeat the same thing over and over and over again. Incidents are not highlighted in red. Let's just stick that into our minds. The red flags are not the actual incidents. They might be precursors to incidents. Red flags are controls that worked. Don't get stuck in any of the process steps. And communication plans really make a difference, a big difference. And sorry, I don't have the attractive Twitter handle with some geeky name. Questions? Thank you.